Welcome to this is the third of our Glimpses into Existence lecture series here at the library. And today we're looking at somebody who's not a philosopher, but has a lot of philosophy sort of rolled into his novels and short stories, and that's Fyodor Dostoevsky. He's considered to be one of the big three in the sort of grandfathers of existentialism in the 19th century. You have Soren Kierkegaard, who we talked about last month, and then you have Dostoevsky, and then we have Friedrich Nietzsche. And then we move into the 20th century, and there's a lot of other existentialists sort of coming out of the woodwork. But a lot of them are tracing their roots back to these three guys, Kierkegaard, Dostoevsky, and Nietzsche. And with Kierkegaard, we had somebody who's explicitly a Christian thinker. He said that his whole task is to actually help people in the realm of Christendom, where they had a state church, become actual Christians. With Nietzsche, we have the opposite. We have somebody who's explicitly anti-Christian and saying that Christianity is Platonism for the masses, and he wants to wean people away from it towards some sort of ideal. And with Dostoevsky, we have somebody who's kind of in the middle. He actually is an Orthodox Christian, Eastern Orthodox, but he tends to give the atheists, the free thinkers, the rationalists more of a say in his works than he does the Christian thinkers. And like Kierkegaard, he's definitely not a party line Christian where the church is always right. It's more about the individual and how they would live out a Christ-like existence. And Dostoevsky knows how many doubts people have, how difficult it can be, and you see that rolled into a lot of the characters or the descriptions in his pieces. So what I'm going to do in this is give you sort of first an idea why we're going to talk about Dostoevsky, because he's not a philosopher. So, existentialism is philosophy. How does this guy fit in? And then we'll talk about his biography a bit, because it helps to see him as a child of the 19th century, and to understand why his characters are the way they are, because they're situated in a particular context. And then I wanted to talk about a little bit about his characters in general. And then there's I've got a few books piled up here. I'm not going to try to summarize all of his work in a one-hour talk. And by the way, feel free to ask questions as we go through this. But I do want to talk about five works very, very briefly. One of them you have a handout on, the Demons or the Possessed. I'm going to talk about Crime and Punishment very quickly. It's a big, big, thick book like that one. But talk about Notes from the Underground at a little bit more length. I'll talk about The Idiot very briefly, and then focus quite a bit on what's sometimes translated as The Possessed, but nowadays it's usually translated as The Demons. And then his master work, his last great novel, The Brothers Karamazov. And I'm only going to focus on, the book is this thick, so we're only going to focus on a tiny little bit of it, because you could spend an entire semester on The Brothers Karamazov. So when we talk about existentialism, like I said, he's not a philosopher, although he knows a lot of philosophy, and he's building a lot of it into his work. Why is Dostoevsky considered to be, within this stream of philosophy? So there's a number of different key themes to existentialist thought that Dostoevsky, he never actually comes out and says, here's what I think in his works. Some people have tried to interpret him to, if we take this character as being Dostoevsky, then here's his actual statement. The Notes from the Underground character often gets that sort of thing. But he's a lot more cagey than that. Instead, what he does is he puts thoughts into the mouths and even more into the lives of characters and then sets them up and lets them interact with each other. And the characters express these existentialist themes. So one of the key themes is actually individuality. What is it to be an individual person? What is it to be somebody who's extricated themselves from, say, just the culture or the crowd or the mass? And for Dostoevsky, this is always within particular contexts, which, again, you know, very typical of existentialists. So the contexts are things like family life, the relationships that people have, work, you know, and sometimes work means being a servant in somebody's household. In some of his books, prison. Dostoevsky himself was in prison for a while, and he writes about that, particularly in the book of in the House of the Dead. Commerce, society. He ranges from the very bottom strata of society all the way to the very top. And within all these levels, you can find people who are struggling to figure out who they are, what their life really amounts to. Another key existentialist theme that you'll see in other thinkers later on is this notion of estrangement or alienation, of feeling that you're not really a good fit for the context that you're in, for the relationships or the time or the culture that you're in. So a lot of these characters are not quite happy with their lives. They're reacting against, you know, not necessarily the system, in a, you know, the capital S, but something that seems to be pervasive, something that runs throughout their society. Dostoevsky, he actually uses the term psychologist to describe his own work, and nowadays we tend to associate psychologists with, you know, things like discussions about happiness or carrying out testing on lab rats, you know, at one extreme, or doing group counseling or things like that. He means something a bit closer to the classical conception of psychology, an investigation of the person's soul, trying to figure out what makes us tick, and digging and digging and digging, because oftentimes the surface explanations or the face that we present to society or even to ourselves doesn't turn out to be the real us. So he spends a lot of time delving into the psychology of his characters, and again, this shows just what a great author he is. You know, they often say, write what you know. If that's the case, then Dostoevsky knew intimately the psyches of people at all different levels of society, of all across the ideological spectrum, from, you know, the most hardcore nihilist, willing to, you know, like Kirillov in The Possessed, willing to say that if God doesn't exist, then he has to become God by killing himself, all the way to these saintly characters who, you know, just present a puzzle to everybody. Dostoevsky encompassed all of these. I don't think you actually have to, you have to know, you know, somebody perfectly in order to write about them. I think you can exercise your imagination. But his force of imagination must have been incredibly powerful to do that. So he's sort of like Shakespeare in that respect. It's very difficult to say who Shakespeare himself as a person really was. It's easier, say, with Geoffrey Chaucer, but even him, it's difficult. These people who are able to take a number of different types and really faithfully explore them, sympathetically explore them, it requires a certain detachment on their own part, a certain, and we saw this with Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard wrote similarly about his own work and the characters that he would create. Another key existentialist theme is the significance of choice in constituting who one is as a person, that nothing is determined. Even to feel as if things are determined, that, you know, one can't possibly choose elsewise, is in fact a choice.
Is that like the free will he talks about?
Yeah, and
Jean-Paul Sartre wrote about that.
Yep, and Sartre is, you know, much later in the existentialist pantheon, so to speak.
Yeah.
And so Sartre, Marcel, Camus, all those French guys, they're reading these people like Dostoevsky and Nietzsche and Kierkegaard. And all these existentialist thinkers think we have free will. Doesn't mean we can do anything we want. Doesn't mean that we can radically change who we are. As a matter of fact, that's a good segue into the next theme, which is the significance of emotion and passion and desire. We're kind of stuck with, you know, the emotional makeup that we have. We can modify it to a certain extent, but some of us are driven by the desire to dominate others, for example, or to always be, you know, come out on top. And you can try to eradicate that. You can see that as a bad thing. But a lot of Dostoevsky's characters have these fatal flaws that they're not able to overcome. But they're aware of them. They're aware of how much this impacts us. Another key thing that you see the existentialist... you know, Sartre is kind of an interesting character in this respect. Sartre had this flirtation with Marxism.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the existentialists are going to be against Marxism. They're going to be against most of the modern philosophies that are popping up. In Dostoevsky's case, it's the sort of rationalism of the French Enlightenment, and then later the German Enlightenment, which gets transplanted into Germany, or into Russia. Come on in.
Hi, good morning.
And then utilitarianism, which is a British, you know, philosophy that makes it big throughout Europe, this notion that you could sort of like rationally reorganize society so it would produce the greatest happiness for the greatest number. Dostoevsky was very attracted to these things as a younger man. And when we talk about his intellectual biography, we'll see where the change took place. And then he's reacting very strongly against these. He's saying that these kind of cut off human beings. They turn them into something like a railway timetable rather than a real human being. Another thing that's really key to existentialists, not only as philosophers, but in terms of literature, is this notion of living out ideas within the context of our own lives, our decisions. His characters talk a lot about ideas, about, you know, broad perspectives, they espouse this philosophy or this philosophy, but they try to live it out. It's not just theoretical, it's practical. Some of them, you know, as we'll see, horrifyingly so. Because it leads to murder, it leads to, you know, suggesting that, in the case of Shigalov, that really the best thing for human beings would be if we enslaved 9/10 of humanity, wiped out a good bunch of them, and then the other 10% would have absolute power over everybody. Not the sort of conception that we want. But well, you know, Shigalov has been compared not so much to Hitler, but to what they call barracks communism, which was, you know, what things turned into under Stalin. Also, Lenin espoused something kind of like this, you know, that you have to, you know, the vanguard will take charge, and everybody else better shut up and submit, and if there's any other parties, just liquidate them, you know. Stalin is sort of carrying that out further than Lenin was, in part because he was a paranoid and saw enemies everywhere. But, yeah, I mean, Hitler was kind of I don't mean to be facetious with this, but kind of an amateur compared to what the Russian revolutionaries were doing, let alone the communists in China, you know, much later. But Dostoevsky has these people living out these philosophies. So everything from this, you know, terrible, you know, humans just deserve to be enslaved, all the way over to love is the answer and the way in which we get to know God. All these people try to live this out. And some with more success, some with less success, in part because of our passions and inconsistencies. So the last thing that I would say that fits in with existentialist themes is the preoccupation with the question of religion. Whether you're an atheist existentialist or a theist existentialist, you know, a Jewish one like Buber, or a Christian one like Gabriel Marcel or Kierkegaard, it's felt by these guys that religion, for better or for worse, matters, and that it ends up being something individuated. I don't want to say individualistic, because that makes it sound sort of like, you know, smorgasbord Christianity, where you just take whatever you like. but more in the sense that if Christianity is going to mean anything, it has to actually center on an individual's life and what it does within that person's life. If it's just something broad, you know, in society as part of the culture, well, then it doesn't really, then it may actually turn into another form of oppression, another way in which people dominate each other. And we'll see that come out most starkly in the Grand Inquisitor, part of Brothers Karamazov, where religion is used to enslave humanity. So Dostoevsky is concerned with all of these things. So it makes sense to say that he's an existentialist author, and it even makes sense to a certain degree to say that he counts as a philosopher, even though he didn't write philosophical treatises. So let's talk a little bit about his intellectual biography. I gave you a handout that has things broken down into two columns. One is life events, and then the other is just, you know, major works that he wrote. And I left out a lot of the, you know, in order to keep it on one page, I didn't put all the short stories in, or, you know, I don't even have all of the novels in there. But you can see the progression of his life. He starts out being born into a family that had made its way into the minor nobility. His father was actually a doctor and then became a college assessor. And so he grew up in Russia while there still was serfdom, and they had estates that had serfs on them. As a matter of fact, his brother blamed his father's death on the serfs driving him nuts. He died in a what they called an apoplectic fit, which basically meant, you know, like losing your temper so badly that you burst a blood vessel, or I don't know what exactly what we would count it as today. But he grew up in that case, but his father was a doctor, so that meant that Dostoevsky also came into contact with a lot of other people, including sick people, patients, because they'd wander around, you know.
Did he grow up in the hospital, on the grounds?
On the grounds,
and
yeah.
And a lot of psychiatric in prison and cemeteries and things.
Yeah, and you know, medicine was, it wasn't so divided up like it is today, where we have, you know, this ward for this and this ward for this. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you were sick, oftentimes they had no idea what was really wrong with you. A lot of the illnesses might have been psychosomatic. And, you know, you'd hear people's stories. And so Dostoevsky, as a young boy, is already encountering these sorts of things. Then he and his brother get sent off to boarding schools and finally military school. He doesn't turn out to be a very good cadet. They actually say that he was, you know, one of the most sad looking guys walking around in his uniform. His uniform looked like feathers on him. But he goes through it. His father and his mother both die while he's in military school. His mother before his father, and he takes a position as a lieutenant engineer and starts to do translation. Then he starts writing, and he writes this book called Poor Folk. That brings him to the attention of this critic, Belinsky. And a little bit of context at the time. We're looking now at around the 1840s. And you remember, Russia was, you know, a fairly conservative society. It had some, you know, liberals, mostly if you started going into the upper classes, the people who wanted to do reforms. But Europe itself had gone through this massive process of enlightenment, and then that led to the French Revolution, led to the Napoleonic Wars, and then there was the counter-reaction against that. So there's a lot of ferment going on. And these revolutionary ideas are going to come to a head in 1848, the year of the revolution. So we're looking at the decade that's leading up to that. Dostoevsky gets involved with this guy, Belinsky. And he likes him at first and then doesn't really like him because Dostoevsky is an Orthodox Christian. Belinsky is an atheist. But Belinsky steers him, in part, to start taking an interest in socialism. And there's a lot of different socialisms at the time. You know, if you read Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto, you see that they spend, you know, like the last third of it basically criticizing all the other socialisms that are out there and saying they're not really the right thing. Socialists spent about as much time attacking each other as they did, you know, the system. And Dostoevsky gets involved in this, and he's getting involved in it right at the wrong time, because the year of the revolution is going to happen, and Russia is going to clamp down. So he gets involved in these socialist circles. He gets involved in a utopian socialist circle, then he gets involved in a Christian socialist circle, who are seen as being very tame. He's already written another book by then, The Double, and it starts work on Nameless Nobody, which is how they translate Natochka Nezanavov. His entire circle gets arrested. Because, the revolution has happened. They want to nip this stuff in the bud. And they're actually condemned to death. And they're taken out to the firing range. And they're lined up. And right at the last minute, their sentence is commuted. So Dostoevsky actually was it may have been sort of just trying to put the fear of God in them.
It was
they say.
Princess Tsar Nicholas sent a message commuting the sentence.
Yeah.
I just read up on it last night.
Yeah, but whether the message had been there before and the officers decided that, well, let's, make sure that these guys know what's going on. It had an incredible effect on him, because he faced death. They commute the sentence to, at that time, what was not quite a death sentence, but was pretty bad in Russia, getting sent to Siberia, being exiled away from European Russia, sent out to the hinterland. And he was also sent to a prison in Siberia, so it's like doubly bad. So he's in Siberia for a while. After he actually gets out of prison there, he has mandatory military service in Siberia. Again, not a very good fit for Dostoevsky, but he goes through all of that. When he's released, he actually writes a book about his prison experience called The House of the Dead, and he starts writing again. His fortunes change. He makes his way into the aristocracy once again. His life is continually haunted by an addiction to gambling, by constantly being in debt, needing advances on his writings, doing ventures like actually trying to start his own publishing house. He has a few journals that he and some other people get involved with starting. None of them turn out to be particularly successful. But he starts, this is the time when he's actually going to start writing his most important work. So all the other stuff has been kind of a preparation till now, because in 1864, Notes from the Underground comes out, then Crime and Punishment, The Gambler, The Idiot, and now we see him starting to have a more domestic life. He's still in debt most of the time, and he also drags his family into debt so badly that his second wife has to sell all of her stuff so that they can pay off some of their debts. He does manage to travel abroad, though, at the same time. So he's sort of like living a life...
the money.
it's sort of... I was thinking about this. It's a life very much like people living on credit cards today, where, a few generations ago... You didn't have credit cards, you paid things up front, right? Or by a check. And if you wrote a bad check, people would know, right? Nowadays, we live in an economy where, especially, they really promote this to the college students, unfortunately. They gave them credit cards so easily. It's very easy to live a lifestyle that, on the surface, appears to have it all together. And at the same time, you're in debt, and it's very difficult to get yourself out of. Dostoevsky lived that way most of his life. It didn't help that he had a gambling addiction.
If you analyze that, a man that was so into free spirit and into... And then yet, was that his release? I mean, if you...
The gambling?
You wouldn't expect that from somebody.
Well, I mean, it's hard to say. He's got these characters that we could be tempted to identify with him. That are willing to just throw everything on the table and take a chance.
There's something else, though. The genius is confronted with people who are in some way unlike him. And he always has to adjust to the fact that he is in some way different from everybody else.
That's true.
Any genius, musical genius, artistic, whatever.
Yeah. And geniuses, when they run into each other, often don't get along. You know? He couldn't get along with Turgenev, who was another great Russian writer.
Yeah, and was it Turgenev or Turgenev? Well, anyway, he criticized Dostoevsky quite severely, yeah. And I felt unfairly.
Well, they sort of represent different... Turgenev identifies with liberalism, with this free-thinking, you know, model yourself after Europe kind of spirit, and Dostoevsky is very clearly against that. In part because, you know, he's reacting against this experience of having been involved in these social circles and having almost, you know, gotten him killed, and thinking there's something wrong with these ways of looking at things. In any case, he doesn't actually, like, make good in his life until pretty late. By the end, he's actually recognized by the Tsar. It's sort of like a fairy tale in some ways. The Tsar actually, you know, says, "You come and present your writer's diary to me. I want you to educate my sons." But this is very, very late in the game.
But isn't it wonderful it ended up like that? Wow. He virtually deserved it, too.
Yeah, he's appointed an honorary member to the Russian Academy of Sciences. He gives this famous speech at the Pushkin Memorial.
And he's thought of as a prophet.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and he thinks of himself as a prophet, too. That's one of the guys who we're going to look at later on, Lev Shestov's criticisms of him, is that he started to believe his own hype at the end.
Usually that doesn't happen until after you die.
That you get to believe things about yourself?
Yeah. Why? Or that you get a credit, you know, the Tsar.
Yeah.
You have to be dead many years before.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of the figures that we're going to... I mean, Kierkegaard, he's not very much read until decades after Nietzsche dies in an insane asylum, and he's, you know, nobody's really looking that much at his work until later on. So actually, yeah, you're right, Dostoevsky, he did make good, and it's nice to have a success story. Yeah.
I think he deserved it, but with a story, a book like The Brothers Karamazov.
I think, you know, yeah, I think you could make a case not only for that, but for The Demons or The Idiot. Those are all such great literature that any one of them could have merited him that.
As an aside, I find the issue that he raised in that book and the debate between Alyosha and his brother about whether creation was all worth it or not.
Yeah.
I find that echoed in contemporary society.
Well,
in many ways, by people who are, you know, otherwise brilliant and extremely talented, but atheists because of the suffering they see around them.
Yeah.
And you have Alyosha's response, which is mine, basically. But
and Zosimus, yeah.
And Zosimus.
Yeah, we're going to come to that in a bit. You're
okay.
Right. That. But this points us towards something very important. Why do we keep reading this stuff? I mean, these are big, thick books, and they're about Russian people that died a long time ago, because they do deal with these universal themes that come up over and over again that we can't escape from. So before we actually look at a few of these things, how are we actually doing on time?
It's 5 after 11.
Oh, okay. So just a few things about his style. A lot of the novels were published in serial form, and I think that's useful to remember when you look at how the chapters are structured. Dickens was another person like this as well, where, you know, each chapter has to be fairly self-contained. And oftentimes these were in journals that were he was trying to make a go of. Now, Dostoevsky doesn't just create a new world, nor does he just imitate the present world. He constructs enough of a world using reference points, and it's surprising, given how much of Russian culture he seems to work in there, that we can make sense of it fairly easily. So he's kind of good in that respect, sort of like, again, like Shakespeare. He delves into the psychology of his characters, and like I said, the characters live out the ideas and perspectives. They're not just didactic. They make decisions, and they present these philosophies or ways of life. Very few of the characters are purely intellectual. Most of them have some sort of emotional substratum that's driving them, some sort of passion. He also has just as much attention on all the other elements and experiences of life, like family life, like coming out in society, for some young man or some young woman. And he focuses a lot on characters. And again, this is probably why his works are so timeless. He focuses on characters that are themselves beset by contradictions, that are trying to, they don't just, you know, have an idea and then go with it. They have doubts about it. They're not sure whether this is the right way to go. And so then they try to do something and see how that works. There's a literary critic, another Russian guy, Mikhail Bakhtin, who wrote about Dostoevsky and calls his works polyphonic novels. And I think that's a good conception. You never actually know who Dostoevsky is presenting as his own side. It's tempting, for instance, to say, well, he must be Zosima because he was a Russian Orthodox, but you never really know. And he tends to put the best arguments in the mouths of the people that he would disagree with. Right?
Well, I find that true in contemporary writers like Bernanos.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's wonderful that you get to hear these critiques of Catholicism at the hands of a Catholic who's writing about the life of a Catholic priest.
Yeah.
It's remarkable.
Graham Greene is kind of like that, too, or Iris Murdoch, you know.
Yeah.
And I don't know them well enough to say whether Dostoevsky influenced them, but that could be the case.
I think he did influence
them. Okay. So let's look at notes from the underground. And I'm not going to try to go through the whole of it. There's just a few parts that I want to focus on. The guy who's narrating it, and I'm only going to focus on the first half, not the narrative second half. The first half, it's this guy, and it's sort of a self-diagnosis of the character, and then some more general reflections about human beings. And this is the one that, if we're doing an existentialism class, in the classroom, we usually assign and say, here's your Dostoevsky, because it's nice and short. The underground man is a reflective person, and he says that he's unable to be something simple. He contrasts himself to most other people who can be, you know, completely good or completely bad, or be, you know, obsessed with this, or be into wine. He can't, it's not that he doesn't have any sort of settled character, it's just that when he tries to force himself to be something, he's always thinking about it. He's always, it's corrosive, the effect that reflection has. He says that his project is trying to find out if other people have the same perverse pleasure that he does. So he says that the more conscious I was of the good and the beautiful, the deeper I sank into the mud, the more likely I was to remain mired in it. When he was confronted with, what he means by the good and the beautiful is it's just a category of the good stuff, what it is that we ought to respect, like, say, family or religion or, you know, innocence. And he'd find himself driven by this desire to knock things down, to denigrate, to say no to them. And he'd know that it was wrong. He'd know that it was bad for him. Then he says, inwardly I gnawed at myself, for it tore at myself and ate myself away until the bitterness turned into some shameful, accursed sweetness, finally into a great, unquestionable pleasure. That's why I started on the subject. I wanted to find out whether others experienced this sort of pleasure too. I derived pleasure precisely from the realization of my degradation, because I felt I was already up against the wall, that it was horrible, but couldn't be otherwise. There was no way out, and it was no longer possible to make myself into a different person. Even if there were still enough time and faith left to become different, I wouldn't want to change myself. And so he says, this is what I'm... This is my project. And then he lays out this whole philosophy about how the reformers, how the rationalists, how the people who want to make human beings better, not only as individuals but in society, have got things wrong. And he says, we have this, at least some of us, this perversity within us that makes us want to, as he says, stick our tongue out at the Crystal Palace. The Crystal Palace is this representation of, you know, rational reorganization of society. And he, so he's rejecting not just the conclusions, but some of the basic premises of these progressive philosophies. He says, can you define what is exactly in the interest of the human being? Suppose the interest of a person is not only consistent with, but even demands something harmful rather than advantageous. You know, the basic idea that a lot of these Enlightenment types had was, if you, you know, people are screwed up, and if you can just show them how they're screwed up and show them that there's a better model over here, they'll sort of like naturally gravitate to it. They'll say, oh yeah, I realize it. I shouldn't, you know, throw all my money away on booze because I'd actually like to be, you know, wealthy and have a nice family life and, you know, pick whatever you like. And they'll just sort of like, you know, once you actually inform people, they'll say, oh, of course, now I get it. And they'll move towards the good. And he says, no. I mean, first look at human history. Is that the way it really works? You know? And then, you know, what if it's actually to our advantage to do things that are harmful for us? And, you know, his interlocutor says, well, then, it, you know, it's still an advantage. He says, well, yeah, but this is a really different kind of advantage. So he says, what is he for? One's own free, unrestrained choice, one's own whim, be it the wildest, one's own fancy, sometimes worked up to a frenzy, that's the most advantageous advantage that cannot be fitted into any table or scale and causes every system and every theory to crumble into dust upon contact. A little bit later, he says, what I'm really for is whim, you know, pure willfulness. He says, what I'm for is whim, and I want the right to use it whenever I want to. So, you know, no matter how much you would argue with somebody like that and say, you know, we'll make a room where you can do your whimfulness. He'd say, well, I'm still going to do it outside of that room. And he'd say, well, look, this is bad for you. I know it's bad for me. That's part of why I want to do it.
And did he do that with his physical pain, his toothache and his...
Oh,
and his liver disease.
And groaning about it.
Yeah, it was bad, it was good. I just hate doctors. Like, yeah, he just couldn't...
Well,
both sides of the same issue.
Yeah, and the, you know, being humiliated. He also talks, and this is kind of interesting, Nietzsche, who we're going to look at next session, talks about something that he calls ressentiment, which is when somebody has a desire for revenge, to you know, sort of respond against aggression towards themselves, but they feel themselves too weak to do so. So they sort of stuff it down, and they become bitter, and they detract, and they turn to an imaginary revenge. So if, you know, you hurt me and I can't do anything about it because say you're my boss, I'll say bad things about you behind your back, and then if I'm confronted about him, I'll like backpedal on that, but then, you know, as soon as you turn around, I'll like, you know, it'll go even deeper, and you know, you might be rich, and I'll say being rich is no good, you know. The rich are jerks. And he talks about something like that in here with how he feels about revenge. He's this mouse who can't really express himself that way. And whereas, a healthy person, a normal person in his view, they get angry. You'd hurt them. They get angry. They take revenge on you. And they feel like they're doing the right thing. He can't, in part because he's so reflective. Because he realizes taking revenge isn't the right thing. I want to do it. I have this desire for it, this passion for it. But unlike the person who thinks he's justified in doing that, I feel bad when I'm doing it. And so there's something very similar to what Nietzsche is calling ressentiment going on in there as well. There's one other passage that I want to mention as well. He says, I'll admit reason is a good thing. No argument about that. But reason is only reason. It only satisfies man's rational requirements. Desire, on the other hand, is the manifestation of life itself, of all of life, and it encompasses everything from reason down to scratching oneself. And although when we're guided by our desires, life may often turn into a messy affair, it's still life and not a series of extractions of square roots. He says reason is only 1/20th of our life, that the rest of it is what, you know, really drives us. So, you know, here's a question we can ask about the underground man. Is this Dostoevsky himself? Is this his full position? And I think the answer has to be no, but this is stuff that he does seem to endorse, because you see it playing out in some of his characters. This this tendency to self-lacerate, to throw it all away. And The Idiot is probably one of the ones where you see this the most, where you have this Christ-like figure, Prince Mishkin, and then you have this woman, Nastasia, and this guy who's pursuing her, Rogozhin, and a lot of the novel turns around the triangle between the three of them. And Mishkin feels sorry for her and you know, exhibits genuine compassion towards her. Actually, at a point, comes to love her. And she loves him because of the way he treats her. But she's attracted to this bad boy, Rogozhin, who actually says, yeah, you know, if we get married, I'm probably going to beat her to death. And she ends up marrying him, and sure enough, he ends up killing her. And Rogozhin knows that he's a bad guy, and recognizes that he ought to do otherwise, and recognizes that he, you know, it'd be better for her not to be with him at all. But he marries her anyway, and pursues her anyway. And she knows that this guy is trouble, and yet she takes him on. And they leave aside this character, Mishkin, who Rogozhin at one point in the novel actually is planning to kill. The only thing that saves Mishkin from it is he has an epileptic fit. And so Rogozhin draws himself back. There's a lot more going on in that novel than that, but I think that's a good little thumbnail sketch of that, and how that might fit in with The Underground Man. Crime and Punishment is another good case. You have this guy who kills a pawnbroker, and he's got this utilitarian argument for it, meaning that, you know, she's a terrible person. You know, she exhibits all these awful traits. She's greedy. She's not using her money for good things. I could kill her, and I could use that money for so many good things for other people. And he does it for that reason, and then he also does it because he wants to see whether he can actually do it, whether a person can kill for those reasons.
And get away with it.
Yeah. And get away with it means not confessing. Because a lot of the novel has to do with whether he's going to actually be able to live with his own guilt. There's getting away with it in the sense of, like, the law not catching you. And he seems to be okay with that for the most part. But it's the guilt that eventually gets him. And why does the guilt get him? Because he comes to realize that, well, even if you can make a utilitarian argument, murder's still murder. It's still wrong. It's complicated by the fact that her sister comes in, and her sister's not you know, the bad person that the pawnbroker is, and he kills her too. So I don't know. Maybe if it was just the pawnbroker, it would have been a different novel. But Dostoevsky sets it up deliberately, so that, you know, the character has to confront that. Let's talk a little bit about some. I don't want to keep people over time. And I want to leave plenty of time for, like, you know, some back and forth discussion. Let's talk about the demons or the possessed. And I actually made a handout about this because this is the novel that I had the hardest time myself with. One of the quirks of Dostoevsky is, you know, like a lot of Russian authors, Turgenev is bad this way too. He'll use the person's first name, their last name, their first name with the patronymic, the diminutive of their name. And so for a while, you know, unless you actually, like, make up a chart for yourself, you can't figure out who the hell's who. And there's a scene in the Demons, it's towards the end of the first part, where there's this big confrontation that takes place. And I actually thought there were more people in the room than were in the room, because they're addressing each other in all these different ways. Yeah, oftentimes the same person's being referred to in different ways. And it's good.
Most easily with that.
It's good, too, because there's so many characters in this, to be able to see how they're connected with each other. And I've got some of these marked in different colors, in part because the real core of the possessed is this living out of different philosophical positions. And so this guy, Stepan Verkhonovsky, he's an older character. He represents the liberalism of the previous generation, this you know, turning towards Europe, progressivism, and we'll talk about that in a moment. He has a son, Fyodor Verkhonovsky, who's one of the main characters, and he's a thoroughly bad guy who's managed to convince everybody, except for the conspirators, that he's a really good guy. And then there's Stepan is essentially the kept man of Varvara Stavrogin, and she was a general's wife. She has a lot of money. She you know, sort of keeps him in style for most of the novel, and actually takes care of him at the very end when he dies. They have this relationship that's not quite a marriage, but is a romantic connection throughout 20 years. She has a son, Nikolai Stavrogin, and he's another major character. And he expresses a certain way of being. And then you have, I mentioned Shigalov before, and we'll look at his views in a moment. And you have Ivan Shatov and von Lemke, the governor. And the governor represents a certain kind of conservatism that Dostoevsky is saying is totally ineffective in the Russia of his day. Shatov represents a sort of nationalistic, the people is God, kind of pan-Slavism. He's the guy who's actually going to be killed by the conspiracy. A lot of the novel revolves around Fyodor organizing this conspiracy, and you see some of the other guys in the conspiracy to kill Shatov. And he's telling them that there's this vast network all across Russia of these revolutionary cells. In reality, they're the only one. And he figures by having them kill Shatov, who used to belong to them, they could all come together. They could gel. And there's more revolutionaries in the town than just that, but I didn't want to make the map too complicated. You've also got this guy Kirillov on the side, who is going to take the blame for the killing. He's willing to kill himself, in part because that's how he's going to, in his view, become God. And you've got this guy Fedka, the convict who used to belong to as a serf, Stepan Verkhonovsky. He lost him at cards, and then he was traded. He lost him at cards. Fedka ends up going into the military, leaving without leave, being sent to prison, breaking out of prison, and he's the one who's actually going to kill Maria and Ignat Lebyadkin. Maria is actually married. She's insane, unfortunately, to Stavrogin. He married her on a whim. So he's sort of like, to a certain degree, like the underground man. So how are all these characters connected? I give you a little rundown of each of them on the next page of the handout. So we've got this guy, Stepan, and he is a failed academic. He was a lecturer, never really made it. He views himself as sort of like, you know, a dangerous type. He's going to, you know, be seen as undermining the social order, but he's totally tame. Nobody really believes his stuff, and nobody sees him as a real threat, except for the governor at one point where the governor is almost like losing his mind. But he is an advocate of the westernizing liberalism. He's also very romantic in the sappy sense. He's given to speaking in French a lot of the time. Russian novels, you know, for a while in the 19th century, it was a cool thing to speak in French as much as possible and not Russian, and this guy does it. So in the edition that I actually have of this, which is an older one, you have to know some French to be able to read what he's saying because they don't translate it in there. And his French isn't particularly good either, by the way. Then you have his son, and Fyodor claims to be a nihilist. And so when we use this word nihilist, it literally means somebody who believes in nothing. In Russia, it was the people who were trying to tear down the society, to reveal all of its pretenses. Sometimes they were about building something new, sometimes they were just about tearing things down. And he claims to be a nihilist, but he's not really one. As a matter of fact, he is sort of a fascist type. Let me read just a passage from him. He wants to use Stavrogin as a kind of unifying figure. So here's a speech by him when he's talking to Stavrogin. He says, "Down with culture. We've had enough science. Without science, we have material enough to go on for 1,000 years, but one must have discipline. The one thing wanting in the world is discipline. The thirst for culture is an aristocratic thirst. The moment you have family ties or love, you get the desire for property. We'll destroy that desire. We'll make use of drunkenness, slander, spying. We'll make use of incredible corruption. We'll stifle every genius in its infancy. We'll reduce all to a common denominator, complete equality. Only the necessary is necessary. That's the motto of the whole world henceforth. But it needs a shock. That's for us, the directors, to look after. Slaves must have directors. Absolute submission, absolute loss of individuality." And, you know, Stavrogin is listening to him, and he's saying, "Yeah, I'm not so, you know, so sure about this." And so Pyotr says to him, "You're the guy that I actually want to be the figurehead. I want you to become Ivan the Tsarevich, you know, Ivan the son of the Tsars." And he says, the great thing is, it will be a new force at work, and we need that. That's what they are crying for. What can socialism do? It's destroyed the old forces, but it hasn't brought in any new. In this, we have a force, and what a force. We only need one lever to lift the earth." So what he's talking about is power for the sake of power. And, you know, all these revolutionary ideas had been sort of tearing down the fabric of conservative Russian society and not leaving anything in its place. And this is one of the dangers that you see, you know, somebody can come in, the general on horseback, if we want to use, you know, some other images, to sort of take power. This, by the way, is exactly what Marx was talking about in his work on the 18th Brumaire, and about, you know, the rise of the Napoleon, not the first one, the later one. So that's a particular philosophy. You can say it's a kind of type of fascism. Kirillov is an engineer, and he really is an atheist. He actually has this view that if he kills himself, he becomes God. Why? Because, you know, if you think about the traditional attributes of God, God's will is completely effective. So he says, if God exists, all is his will, and from his will I cannot escape. If not, it's all my will, and I'm bound to show self-will. All will has become mine. Can it be that no one in the whole planet, after making an end of God and believing in his own will dare to express his self-will on the most vital point? It's like a beggar inheriting a fortune and being afraid of it and not daring to approach the bag of gold, thinking himself too weak to own it. I want to manifest my self-will. I'll be the only one, but I'll do it. So he's saying that suicide is the most powerful expression of one's own, you know, imposition of one's will upon the universe. So that is pretty nihilistic. Shigalov, like I mentioned, Shigalov is kind of a funny character. He's got this whole system worked out, and it just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And he says, "I'd like to, you know, talk to you about it, but I'm going to have to schedule 10 lectures because I have 10 chapters. And each night I'll tell you about one of the chapters." And he's got it like down to, you know, who's going to do what with what property. You know, it's very much, imagine Plato's Republic written by a complete madman. And instead of being, you know, 10 chapters or books long, an entire bookshelf. And that's Shigalov. And then we have Shatov. And Shatov is a curious type. He represents the Pan-Slavism that was, you know, sort of taking hold of Russia in the time. He says, "The object of every national movement and every people and at every period of existence is only the seeking for its God." So it's got a religious aspect to it. But then he says, "The God must be its own God, and the faith in him is the only true one. God is the synthetic personality of the whole people, taken from its beginning to its end. And a little bit later, he gets accused of reducing God to nationality. He says, on the contrary, I raise the people to God. Has it ever been otherwise? The people is the body of God. Every people is only a people as long as it has its own God and excludes all other gods on earth, irreconcilability. So long as it believes that by its God it will conquer and drive out of the world all other gods. That's what he's about. And remember, he's the one who's going to be killed. And then we have von Lemke. And von Lemke represents, like I said, a certain kind of conservatism, meaning he stands for order and maintaining, you know, status hierarchy, but he's totally ineffective. And this is, you know, really sort of a foretaste of what's going to happen in Russia. The conservatives are unable to even figure out how far these other people are willing to go. And they think that if they can just, you know, repress them, that all this will go away. And it won't. Because now that these ideas are there, the reason why the book is called The Demons is because these ideas are like demons. They possess people. And they can possess an entire nation. So, you know, where is Dostoevsky's position in all of this? It's not actually really that represented, except perhaps by Nikolai Stavrogin, who doesn't have a philosophy. Instead, he's this rather generous, free-thinking character, but he's also a person who's done some terrible things in his past. And eventually he will hang himself over that, over his guilt and his involvement in this. He gets involved in the conspiracy in part because he's just, you know, not willing to say no to being involved with these people until they start doing things where he lays down a limit. But by that time, he's already part of the process. And his wife gets killed because of that, by Fedka. And he's, you know, on the one hand, he's this very generous, very heroic character. On the other hand, he's not able to see his way out of it. So he's a tragic character. So we don't actually get to see what would arguably be Dostoevsky's real position until the brothers Karamazov, because we don't have somebody who's like, you know, Eastern Orthodox Fyodor Dostoevsky. If indeed Alyosha, one of the brothers Karamazov, and his what would you call him, teacher or mentor, spiritual director, the elder Zosima, are supposed to be Dostoevsky, which is probably the best candidate for his position, we're not really getting that until the end. And the brothers Karamazov, what time have we got? Well, we're actually a little bit over time. What I'll do is I'll just give you a very, very quick sketch of some of the things that are going on in there. There's three brothers. One of them is, there's three brothers of a really screwed up father, whose name is Fyodor, by the way. Fyodor Karamazov, who's a womanizer, a drunk, will sleep with basically anybody. And he's got an older son, Dmitri, who's like him. And they actually, like, you know, end up pursuing the same woman at one point. Then by another mother, he has these two brothers, Ivan and Alexei, or Alyosha. And Alyosha is the younger one, and he's the one who's attracted to religion, in part because he's really attracted to the notion of love. And for Dostoevsky, he puts this great speech in the mouth of Zosima, the elder. A lot of the issues about does God exist or stuff like that can't be resolved through philosophical argument. This is what Zosima says about it to a woman who's struggling with faith. He says, nothing can be proved, although one can be convinced. And she says, how? By what? And he says, by acts of love. Try to love your neighbors, love them actively and unceasingly. And as you learn to love them more and more, you'll become more and more convinced of the existence of God and the immortality of your soul. And then later on she says, well, you know, I have all these ideas about that. He says, no, it's not about ideas. It's about actually doing things. He says, A true act of love, unlike imaginary love, is hard and forbidding. Imaginary love yearns for an immediate heroic act that is achieved quickly and seen by everyone. A true act of love requires hard work and patience, and for some it's a whole way of life. And so, you know, for these philosophical problems, there's only a practical solution. There's not a theoretical solution that's going to be completely convincing. Because in Ivan's mouth, Ivan and Alyosha have this back and forth that during the course of which Ivan, in two chapters, first lays out the problem of evil, the problem of suffering, and says, you know, if your God is all love and everything's supposed to make sense in the end, what about these children that are suffering? And he lays out cases that would rival some of the things that we see happening even today, you know, that we see in the newspapers, some of the horrific abuse that children suffer. So he's putting the problem in its absolute starkest form. He says, leave aside the rest of humanity. Maybe those bastards had it coming to them. You know, I don't know. But these kids, how can that suffering possibly be redeemed? This is the traditional problem of evil that we talk about in philosophical theology. Then he lays out this whole, what he calls a poem of the Grand Inquisitor. And if you're not familiar with this, and Christ shows up back on earth in Spain during the Inquisition, and the Inquisitor throws him in jail and says, we're going to burn you tomorrow. And then he like berates him, and he says all sorts of things to him about the, you know, the three temptations, that Christ actually got it wrong, that he loved humanity too much, gave them freedom, and that human beings don't really want freedom. He says, this is a great passage. He says, do you know that more centuries will pass and men of wisdom and learning will proclaim there's no such thing as crime, there's no sin either, there are only hungry people. Feed us first, then ask for virtue. That will be the motto on the banners of those who oppose you, of those who will raise your temple and build in its place a new terrifying Tower of Babel. And although they will never complete it any more than they did the last one, nevertheless, you could have prevented men from making the second attempt to build the tower and shorten the sufferings of 1,000 years. All you had to do is take power. All you had to do was tell people to sit down, shut up, and stay in their place. And that's paraphrasing. Right? He says, we will give them bread in your name and wine, telling them that it's in your name. Never would they have been able to feed themselves without us. So in the end, they will lay their freedom at our feet and say to us, enslave us, but feed us. And they will finally understand that freedom and the assurance of daily bread for everyone are two incompatible notions that could never coexist. They will also discover that men can never be free because they are weak, corrupt, worthless, and restless. So, you know, one solution to the problem of social discord and what complete jerks we are to each other is to impose order and do so in the name of humanitarianism and take away freedom. And Christ never responds in this other than to kiss the Inquisitor. And the Inquisitor goes on and justifies, you know, his position at great length as being the really good position, being what one ought to do. This is sort of a puzzle that Dostoevsky is putting in front of us. I think that you can say that he is a lot like Kierkegaard in that Christianity, if it's going to mean anything, is going to have to be something that's lived out. It's not going to be something that can resolve all the philosophical problems or doubts for somebody in the way of, like, you know, shutting everybody else up, but that it's something that one can work out on their own. Alyosha, you know, sticks with his faith for the most part, and although there's some worries here and there, but what allows him to do that is this, like I said, this practical solution rather than a theoretical solution of trying to love. And it's not just a matter of, like, having, you know, love pouring out of you. It's like Zosima said, it takes acts of love, a choice to behave in that way. So that's where we're left. I mean, this is his greatest work. You're right on about that. And it's extremely dense, and we haven't gone through more than just a sliver of it. But we've talked a lot about these themes. So Dostoevsky really solidly fits into this existentialist spectrum. So we have some time. I'm not sure where my wife and children are right now, but so until they show up, we certainly have some time for discussion or comments or questions.
When you were just talking about religion and it should be lived out, isn't that often though what organized religion does do? They separate. Yeah. They judge. Theirs is the right way and maybe the only way. So many wars in the world. A thought of a religion. Is he reaching to that point even back then?
Dostoevsky thought at one point that there were three like world systems in play. One was Catholic, and he had this view of Catholicism. You know, it was basically just the Inquisition and the Jesuits and the Pope. You know, so if he'd spent more time, I think, in Catholic countries, he probably would have had a bit more of a receptive attitude towards that. But he thought that it was really just about, you know, power. And
well, it is.
Well, I mean, yes and no. I mean, there's if you spend a lot of time with Catholics, you'll find out that they're all over the map, you know, and that it's a mistake to lump them all into.
I would say that's true.
That they're all over the map.
Yes.
Yeah, and same thing with Orthodoxy. I mean, Dostoevsky thought that Orthodoxy was the way because it's all about love and stuff like that. But I mean, you could look at things that have been done by the Orthodox. Right now, the Russian Orthodox Church being used to justify all sorts of things going on in Russia. But again, when you start looking at individuals and how they're living out that religion, which, you know, and the other thing, it's not as if the institutional organized thing doesn't have any role, because how do people learn about God? It's not like they just walk around and go up to the Bible tree and pull a Bible off and start reading the New Testament. It helps to have some catechesis. It helps to have some good catechesis, because unfortunately it's often terrible. I know it was for me as
a
kid.
What did you grow up in?
I grew up as a Catholic, but I grew up in the 70s, and it was this watered down, God is nice and be nice to each other kind of stuff. It wasn't the Baltimore Catechism,
because
that had been like, we swung to the complete opposite extreme, and I was like, well, what do I need this for? You know, what are we doing here at this?
Can I say that it seems to me that Christianity is the object of the world's judgment?
Explain that a little bit. That's an interesting
thing. Well, that's crucifixion.
The object of the world's judgment.
In other words, we're about to enter the passion of Christ.
Yeah.
Liturgy. It seems to me that is the definition of Christianity.
That it has to involve the suffering as well as love. Yeah. I mean, to commit to love means...
I mean, rather than being the judge of the world, it is the object, meaning the object of the world's judgment.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is the core of the faith.
How does that play out for an individual, then? They have to be willing to subject themselves to...
No, don't have to be anything.
Okay.
Don't have to be, which is, I think, the point. It's don't have to be anything.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to get so...
No. So if we move then from...
Once you start saying it have to, then you become the judge.
I see, yeah. So instead
of saying... If I say, well, you're not performing the way you're supposed to as a Christian.
Instead of saying have to, then it becomes a matter of choose to, right?
It'd be a matter of what?
Choose to, or commit to.
Well, that's the whole problem in Catholicism. I'm a big rebel against have to, because that's an inauthentic response to either God or your neighbor or to faith.
Yeah.
And want to or choose to is the only authentic beginning for any spiritual choice.
I have to say, from my experience within it, that it doesn't end up being a problem, because most Catholics don't do what they're supposed to do anyway. These days, at least.
I spoke to an Anglican about that who's married to a Catholic. Rather progressive. He said that's the prevailing hypocrisy in the church, that they teach all this and then nobody's doing it.
What about Bonhoeffer? Bonhoeffer did it.
Yes, but he was a man. He was an authentic Christian and an individual
right.
who was responsible for his own faith, which is a good thing.
I mean, very often within the church, you have people who are doing what they're supposed to do, and then end up getting persecuted within the church. You know,
you mean following the rules or following Jesus?
Following Jesus, which sometimes actually does mean following the rules, if the rules are the right rules, you know, and that's true. You know, because a lot of times people run into problems. It's not just that there's rules and rules are always bad or something like that.
Exactly.
Sometimes there's good rules and then they don't follow. People don't follow those. You know.
Yeah.
So.
Well, what I'm interested in is when you first encountered the church in the 70s.
As a kid.
It didn't impress you as something worthy of commitment to?
No, because it was, you know, what we got was sort of either the remnants of the Baltimore Catechism days, or just shut up and you know, obey and believe, or it was the sort of everything is totally up for grabs so long as you act nice to everybody else. And that didn't, there was nothing there to, like, you know, I needed something that I could understand. There was nothing, there's
so
no attempt to provide.
How
something.
Did you progress from that later?
Well, I ended up going to Catholic high school and leaving the church while I was in high school, and they were so tolerant that they were A-okay with that. And then I didn't come back until my late 20s, and it was through studying philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And reading people like Thomas Aquinas and Anselm, basically so I could study Latin better, and then being attracted to it, and reading, also reading people like, you know, you brought up Bernanos and Graham Greene, and what's that?
Did you read any Merton?
A little bit, but I'm much more interested in the sort of...
novelistic.
Well, the troubled this-worldly people, then. Merton is kind of a mystic, and I'm not much of a mystic.
Yeah.
But I found myself being drawn in, and I can't make any claims about my faith life being anything other than a shambles or, you know, having made much progress. But I at least, for me, a lot of these problems resolve themselves in terms of, you know, sort of what we're talking about here.
Mm-hmm.
Not in terms of, like, making sense of church history as a whole or anything like that. So I find people like Dostoevsky or Kierkegaard very sympathetic. I think that's probably why I'm attracted to it.
Mm-hmm. And did you stay with your renewed Catholicism or leave that at?
Well, yeah, but I'm a very bad Catholic in the sense that I know what I should do, but don't do it all that well. You know,
what should you do?
I should be a lot more loving than I am.
That's true.
You see, as soon as you use the word should, it just blows my mind.
Well, yeah.
You simply,
mean, there's different senses of should, though.
Then,
right?
you're an ideologist. I don't mean you. I'm not talking about you personally. I'm talking about that is a doorway to ideology.
Yeah.
Therefore, it sort of, it becomes an, it then becomes
Let
the
me rephrase
judge.
That.
It
yeah.
becomes the judge of Christ.
Let me rephrase it then. If I were to be more loving, I would be much more in line with the values that I actually see there, that I know are real, and that I know I should be moving towards. And, you know, like Dostoevsky's Underground Man, I find myself quite often, like, you know, saying, boy, what the hell is wrong with you? You know what you should be doing. There's that word should again. But,
right.
You know, it's the should is, there can be should in the sense of, like, somebody coming down on you and thou shalt, you know. But then there's should in the sense of there's something over there that's genuinely good that I should, I ought to be over there. I ought to be attracted to that. That's real. And I'm not there.
Right.
And I think those are very different senses of should, you know. In one, there's something genuine. In the other, it's just imposition. And if there is anything over there, who knows, because you're so concentrated on fulfilling the requirements, you know. What do you think of that idea? What the two senses of should in that case. Would that resolve that?
Well, what I would like to know is, I found as a convert that when things began to go the other way, and you got a resurgence of all this medieval stuff, which I could vomit at, like the purgatory, and some mortal sin to miss Mass on Sunday, and all of the evils of the free-swinging Vatican II reform, and we don't need that. Even the conservatives who don't even think Pope Francis is Pope because Benedict had no right to resign, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You know, I got to the understanding from my experience in Protestantism and sociology and experience being a convert from the hippie lifestyle that the church was not ready for the freedom that the Vatican II reform allowed them, rather than it being a mistake. And they have to learn to grow into it, and that could take a long time.
Yeah,
because if it's all about feel good and be nice, there is something more to it than that.
Yeah.
But to go back to the old rigorous rules is to invite heresy, like justifying yourself through your own efforts and your religious activity, which is not what Christianity is about.
Yeah.
So there are basic truths, I think, which are universal to Christianity and Catholicism, which Catholicism is too proud yet to admit, are owned sometimes by Protestants.
Oh, but there's been a lot of...
Some Catholics.
Yeah. I mean, I think there, in recent years, and especially since Vatican II, there's been a lot of like actually dialoguing with Protestants and saying, wow, you guys are actually better on the ball about this thing or that thing. Than we have been, and also with the Orthodox too, going back to the Church Fathers, and there's been more humility in that way. I guess you could say that you can always use more humility, you know. I'm reminded of this thing that Flannery O'Connor once said to somebody who, in a letter to this guy who was like, you know, he was attracted to Christianity, he wanted to convert. He said, "Boy, your church is a bunch of jerks. You know, they behave terribly," and she said, "Well, you know, you're expecting the church militant to be the church triumphant. You're expecting, you know, this bunch of people that are often, you know, like one step away from being terribly badly off, to and who are the body of the church on earth, to actually be like the, you know, the people at their end state, you know, when they're fully." Developed, or, you know, when they're up in heaven with God, and if that's your expectation, then you're never going to join the church because, you know, that's what you've got are these schmucks who, you know, are always about ready to start attacking each other and misunderstanding each other, but this is as good as we've got. That was what she said to this guy. I don't remember if it worked.
Excellent. I'll see you next month.
Yeah, thanks for...
And it's May 1st.
Next...
May 1st. Yeah, the way the April calendar works, there's two in May. So it's May 1st and May 29th instead of the last...
That's right,
Saturday,
you're not doing
April.
An April one, yeah.
Yeah, there was something else going on, I think another event.
Yeah.
But we have your... Well,
fine.
We'll
That's
see.
Very good.
Yeah, good to see you
I'll
again.
I'll see it on the newsletter.
Can I, just before I run, if you can just quickly sum up then Dostoevsky's, you know, religious or theological, you said he was halfway between the two extremes, in a nutshell, how would you, oh, does he not want us to know, because
well,
he never wants
I mean,
to
in his practice, he was a church-going Eastern, well, some of the time church-going Eastern Orthodox.
But
guy.
In his writings, did he talk about what we're talking about at all?
No, because he doesn't reveal... himself.
Then why does he
such.
Do that, do you think? Is that common in authors? Like, or do they not know who they are to be, or they want
no,
to be
it's,
all
it,
of it?
There could be a couple different reasons. One could be it leaves things open so people can use
Choose.
It to make their way
right,
through.
Right, which is good.
I mean, you know, like Green or Berenos or some of the other people, we could ask that of them too, right?
Well, my thinking is that the gospel is so simple that people have to complicate it just to satisfy their pride, because it's enormously simple and there's nothing really so demanding in the sense that to do something that simple is demanding.
Yeah, when you actually leave it alone and say, if you get angry with your brother, you sinned, you know.
Yeah, but the problem there is that if you're angry, you can also do something if you hurt somebody, you can try to make reparation. If you can't do anything about it, you can have a change of heart.
Yeah.
If you're at the end of your rope, you can ask God to help you. You might have to just ask God to allow God to love you and receive that love first before you can share it with somebody else. But the whole thing hinges, as I see it, on pride complicating things because people don't want to do it God's way. And if we did it God's way, we'd have a lot clearer perspective of what we're supposed to be doing. And it wouldn't be so difficult. And yeah. There would be ways we could find to reach out to other Christian denominations and we wouldn't have all these divisions.
Yeah.
I think people are tremendously flawed. And right now I'm at my wit's end with some of the stupidity I find in Catholicism. But the thing that's interesting is that if you go online and post at the end of this NCR blog, I find some people thinking the very same thoughts I do, who are sometimes tolerant, who can have a discussion. That's very rare. Usually they come at me, the fundamentalists, and try to show me where I'm wrong.
Yeah.
All I'm arguing for is the idea that we should be able to treat one another with some modicum of respect and grant each other some sense of liberty and autonomy insofar as how we perceive our lives and in the exercise of free conscience.
Well, that would be the loving thing to do, too.
Yeah.
Sometimes, though, don't you think that, and I realize I entered the conversation sort of in the midst, but we don't, as people, know what to ask for. Because I think, you know, there's the sense of, like, if you're struggling and you pray or ask for strength, you know, you'll get the strength to continue to carry whatever burden it is that you have. But if you ask for something else, like patience or understanding or a way to put that burden down. But we don't always ask for that. What we ask for is the endurance part and not necessarily the grace part. You know, the ability to sort of find a different route or a different way.
Yeah.
But I like what you're saying about the, you know, keeping things open and not being so clear and definitive, because I think that there's an isolation, you know, tendency toward isolation, where there's this great richness that could be found and the interpretation is denied because it's reserved just for this group over here, just for this, you know, like he was saying, the ideology. Because I think your should-ought thing still is overly complicated. I think it's more,
you mean
you
the
know,
distinction that I made between
yeah, in a way,
two
because
different kinds
it's
of
not...
Should?
It's not the should oppressive should. There is that, and there's the ought internal ought, and there is that. But there's also just simply a kind of life would be better if I were more loving.
That's the part over there that I was talking about.
Right, and I think that's the piece that a lot of people miss. It's not, you know, it's not just obeying or, you know, enforcing internally, right?
Yeah.
It's this concept of being able to say, well, I'm making an active choice. It will be better if I am more loving. It will be better for myself, for those I encounter. It will be better today, and then it will be better tomorrow.
I think what makes it so hard for a lot of people is you actually have to have some sort of experience of that thing over there
that
would be
true.
Better, that can attract you, and that you... I mean, the pride does interfere with actually being able to say, I'm screwed up, but it would be better for me to be over there. Pride makes you say, no, I'm great right here, and that's no good. But unless you actually have that experience, like think about, you know, I could say that one of the reasons why I got turned off when I was a kid was I didn't have experiences of people, at least in church, being loving in the way that I probably needed. And if I had that, it's easier to see that and then say, yeah, I want that sort of thing.
Yeah,
I did have it later on though.
Yeah,
you know?
Good.